You know, one advantage of living in Asia is that once in a while, when walking around, you can come upon some really unusual products. And so very recently, when I was basically looking for Legos, and as some of you may know, I'm a huge Lego fan, I found a store that was selling these Chinese knockoff Legos at extremely affordable prices. And interestingly enough, some of them were space-themed. And so I actually bought this one of Hermann Oberth, the unofficial father of rocketry and astronautics, who also has the iconic Oberth effect named after him. This is the effect I explored in super old videos using Kerbal Space Program, where generally a spacecraft can gain a lot of energy by executing its engines at the lowest point of its orbit, which would then give it a dramatic boost and increase its orbit with much higher efficiency than would be otherwise possible. Although more importantly, he's also a father of a lot of other concepts, and in Chinese astronomy, he's widely respected for his achievements. Thus, the knockoff Legos with this unusual satellite. There was a bunch of other ones, which I also bought because they were so cheap, but the important point I'm making here is that... Wait, what's the point I'm making? Yeah, the set was pretty cool. Okay, hello wonderful person. Today we're going to be talking about Chinese achievements when it comes to space telescopes, and more importantly, we're going to be discussing two upcoming space telescopes that are going to be extremely exciting and very influential in their ability to produce very beautiful images, very similar to the iconic Hubble telescope, and possibly even similar to the James Webb. Oh, wait, I remember my point now. The reason I started with Hermann Oberth is because he was the first to propose an idea of an orbiting telescope where the astronomers, or in this case astronauts, would live and work observing various objects without the interference from the atmosphere. And though his idea was a little bit more advanced than what we currently have, we eventually got to that point. We started launching telescopes in space, and there are quite a lot of them out there, several dozen as a matter of fact, although only some of them are still operational. But as of 2013, China has also joined in on the race and has actually produced some really impressive telescopes as well. Now, their first one is not truly a space telescope, as it is more of a rover telescope. It was on board of the Chang'e 3 mission, the lunar mission that actually had an ultraviolet telescope as one of the instruments. And all this worked just fine starting in 2013. But their second telescope, known in Mandarin as Wukong, or in English as Dark Matter Particle Explorer, or DUMPY, is an actual space telescope currently trying to find dark matter particles. Not really successful yet, but you never know. Their third telescope, HXMT, is an X-ray telescope that's been extremely successful to date. As a matter of fact, we've recently discussed one of its major discoveries. You can find this video somewhere in the description. And now they have two more planned, both of them optical telescopes, very likely much more powerful than Hubble, with one being extremely interesting. So the first one is going to be launched in 2023, has a really interesting design. So far we've actually referred to this as the Chinese Hubble, simply because it has very similar structure. In Mandarin this is known as Zhuntian, and the name means Space Sentinel, or Space Observer. It's going to feature a 2-meter diameter mirror, extremely similar to the one on the Hubble Space Telescope. But because it's also going to have a 2.5 gigapixel camera on board, it's going to have a much wider field of view. And so in other words, even though Hubble was able to sort of look at the image and provide a lot of detail of that particular image, this here is going to be able to do the same, but focusing on an area that's approximately 300 times wider, allowing it to literally scan the night skies really fast and possibly even produce deep field images much, much faster and with a lot more detail than was previously possible. Naturally, in the process producing a lot of beautiful images, but also discovering things we've never known existed. As a matter of fact, the scientists in this case expect this telescope to map approximately 40% of the night skies throughout its mission, which will allow the scientists to produce a kind of a deep field observation of 40% of everything around us, which is way more than the Hubble telescope, because that telescope was only able to focus on just that one thing. But more importantly, this mission is going to have a very unique profile. We've discussed this in that previous video about the Chinese space station. In this case, it's going to directly depend on the Tiangong space station that's currently being built by China, and is actually going to once in a while dock to it in order to receive repairs or possibly upgrades, and then undock, going on its merry way, conducting various observations and doing all sorts of science. In other words, it's a kind of a modular telescope that's going to be technically part of the space station. Its spectrum is going to be also very similar to Hubble, in this case infrared, visible and UV light, and so when Hubble is no longer operational, which could be pretty much any day now, This is most likely going to become the go-to telescope for a lot of optical observations when they need to be done fast. But what about James Webb telescope, you may ask? Its actual mission profile is just a little bit different. It's really more of an infrared telescope than anything else. But just like the Hubble telescope, in this case, Sun Tian telescope is going to be able to point itself in various directions really quickly and conduct a lot of observations much, much faster than anything else before. Very likely remaining the largest space telescope for astronomy in the near ultraviolet and visible light for at least 10 years. And though interestingly, originally the scientists were actually trying to attach this telescope to the space station itself, they quickly realized that it would be just impractical. Because of various vibrations on the station, it would be very likely impossible to use it. And so instead, they chose to change the profile and turn it into an actual space telescope. Installing all the necessary parts required for refueling or any kind of repairs, which in the end also made it a lot more affordable than any space telescope produced by NASA, even the Hubble telescope. To repair or to service a Hubble telescope, NASA actually had to launch the space shuttle missions, with each of these being relatively expensive. And between 1993 and 2009, 5 missions were launched to Hubble, overall costing way more than this entire telescope and 10 years of its operational costs. And so in approximately 2 years from when I'm making this video, in 2024, we might finally see the first light from this telescope, which, to be honest, is probably going to be absolutely incredible. And more importantly, this might also create a lot more opportunities for various scientists to collaborate with the scientific community in China. And quite a lot of missions are already planned for this telescope, including the potential galactic dust map of our own galaxy, the Milky Way, or various observations in regards to how black holes absorb the material around them. And after 10 years, by 2035, it's very likely going to produce a huge amount of data, and if everything goes well by 2035, we're going to have an extremely beautiful deep field of a huge part of the universe. Something that doesn't have a name yet, but I guess for now we can refer to it as a super deep field. But that's telescope number one. A few years after the launch of Sun Tian, China is also planning something else, something even more original. Something that was inspired by NASA's Kepler Space Telescope, the most prolific planet finder that operated between 2009 and 2018. The telescope that identified over 10,000 various exoplanets that are still being confirmed even today. But what's sort of unusual is that out of these 10,000 planets, not a single one seems to resemble planet Earth. The vast majority of planets discovered so far are extremely different from anything we have in the solar system, and obviously very different from what we live on. And so this new Chinese telescope is going to try to change that. Its main mission is to discover planets very similar to planet Earth, as similar as it can get. We actually even have a numerical value for all of this. It's known as the ESI, Earth Similarity Index. And so very recently, 300 various scientists released this new data with a title that you see right there. A paper whose main purpose is to find the first Earth 2.0. And it will do so by scanning the night skies, looking for planets just like the Kepler telescope, but by using something slightly different. It's going to maximize its depth of field and thus the ability to see planets farther away by essentially combining several different telescopes into one. Their goal is to create a larger telescope out of 6 smaller ones. In this case, 6 smaller 30cm telescopes are going to form a mirror very similar to the one on Kepler, 1.5 meters in diameter, with the 7th telescope designed specifically for microlensing events, which in the past have actually helped us discover various planets as well, even using a Kepler telescope that was not designed for it. With the 7th instrument specifically focusing on the rogue planets or the free floating planets, with one very interesting one discovered not so long ago actually being somewhat similar in mass to planet Earth. The video should be somewhere in the description. With the mission then launching to the same area where we have the James Webb telescope and staying there for at least 4 years, sending back home at least 170 gigabytes of data every single day. And because its cameras and its mirrors are going to be way more advanced than the ones on the Kepler telescope, the actual results are going to be much more impressive as well. And the preliminary calculations from the scientists suggest that they're going to be able to find nearly 30,000 new planets, including very likely almost 5,000 Earth-sized planets, and at least 10 to maybe even 20 Earth 2.0-like planets by 2030. That's at least based on the preliminary assumptions. If the scientists discover more, great. But if the scientists discover less or none, that's of course where we have a bit of a mystery. Is Earth truly unique? because based on the analysis from the Kepler telescope, so far it looks that way. But because this telescope is going to be launched within the next 4 years, chances are China might be the first to discover Earth 2.0 if it does exist, allowing the scientists using the James Webb telescope then collaborate and discover the actual details about the atmosphere of this planet or if it even has life on it. Now, all of this is obviously still speculative and we don't really know what these telescopes are going to discover, but for now it does look promising, at least in terms of the basic assumptions based on the current math. The scientists in this case go into a lot of detail explaining why they believe their telescope is going to be quite efficient at finding these Earth 2.0 planets. Most of this is of course based on the results from the iconic Kepler telescope and from a lot of recent discoveries as well, so at least statistically, they're correct. But if in practice we find none, that's of course where things get really interesting. And one of the missions here is of course to also look for potential technosignatures or signs of alien life somewhere out there by, for example, looking at various industrial pollutants such as CFCs, or specific types of radio emissions, or specific chemicals produced by certain types of life here on Earth. So this telescope is going to be able to see that as well. Although interestingly, it's also going to be competing with PLATO, Planetary Transits and Oscillations of Stars, ESA's telescope launching around the same time, the one we're going to be discussing in one of the future videos, and the one that, at least in theory, could also be great for discovering some kind of an Earth-like planet, if it exists. But more about this in one of the future videos. But we're actually also going to be talking about the Chinese telescopes once they get closer to that launch mission, and once the space station is finished as well. At least for now, well, that's pretty much it. These two telescopes, if successful, are going to actually provide us with a lot of extremely useful data and potentially discover so many things we've never known existed. But more importantly, they're going to be filling that niche that's currently not filled by any other telescope. One of them is going to be surveying the entire universe, kind of similar to what Hubble used to do, and one of them is going to be looking for planets. And so in that sense, both missions are going to be super important. But until they launch, or until we learn something else, well, I guess that's pretty much it. Thank you for watching, subscribe if you still haven't, share this with someone who loves learning about space and sciences, and come back tomorrow to learn something else. Maybe support this channel on Patreon by joining Gen membership, or by buying the Wonderful Person t-shirt you can find in the description. Stay wonderful, I'll see you tomorrow, and as always, bye bye.